I'm terrific. Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to your class here. I'm very excited to hopefully impart some information that's useful. We'll see. Oh, well, the last picture I did was called Impact Earth. And you've never seen a movie like this. It's about giant meteors that are going to destroy the planet. And never. And it was probably, you know, it was a low budget picture. We did it for under $1 million. And it when I got the call to do it, it was just, I said, sure, let me see the script. The script was completely wacky, had to be rewritten. And, basically, I spent like the first 5 weeks in pre-production rewriting the script, giving my notes. Initially, it was for the Stars Network. So giving my notes to Stars as well as the producers to have them all agree on how I planned to change the movie to make it better. And some of it worked, some of it didn't. Well, I mean, again, I haven't had an agent or a manager in about 10 years, actually longer than that. It's very difficult to get one because now what's happened in the industry is, A, I'm older. B, I've done a lot of movies that no one's ever heard about, primarily TV movies. And agents are looking for young, talented folks that have something that the studios want, because that's where they make a lot of their money. I'm kind of have been a journeyman director, basically getting calls when people have a little bit of money, but they have to deliver something, because that's what I've always done. Taking, as they say, a turd and putting a ribbon on it and making it not smell as bad as it normally does. Well, no, I mean, again, it's, you know, I've done a lot of low budget TV shows, you know, syndicated 1 hour shows. As a producer and as a director, and because I started as a producer before I became a director, it helped me learn the craft of directing and learn the shortcuts that you need to know in order to finish a movie on schedule and on budget. Because, you know, a lot of times, every time I do a movie, I set out to make it the best that it can be. However, there are certain limitations, primarily budget and time to shoot it. And sometimes there are more characters that you have to cut out. So, I mean, I approach every project twofold, as a producer and as a director. As a director, I look at it from a creative storytelling standpoint. From a producer, I look at it, how the heck can I make this the best thing, given the budget and the time to shoot it? Right. Well, plus, you know what happens is I've been making movies for 35 years. And every time I start a new project, I try to forget what I know. Because in having done so many shows, you almost somewhat, it's not that you become jaded, but you kind of lose that creative edge sometimes. Yeah. And I remember I was directing a picture and the producer said something very interesting to me. He and I had produced movies. He knew I was a producer. And he said to me, he said, "Rex, forget you're a producer. Forget everything you know about producing. You're the director now. You're the creative force. I want you just to focus on that. Let me handle the producerial problems." So young directors or young people that aspire to be directors aren't hamstrung by their own knowledge because they still have every kind of crazy idea, which is what's wonderful about filmmaking and what's wonderful about exploring your ideas and seeing what works. Sometimes it'll work, sometimes it won't, but that's how you learn. And the fresher your ideas, the better. Now, that all has to work within the confines of making a movie and, you know, making a TV show and telling a story visually, which is what directors do. And also what's important is that you understand the tools that you have to tell that story. And that's one thing that when I went to film school, the best thing I got out of it was actually the film theory classes, watching great old movies, learning why they did certain things and how they work and why they worked. As opposed to, you know, when I was in film school, MTV had just started. So everyone was doing all this wacky stuff on MTV that worked, but it was just totally different. And a lot of those filmmakers then took that into the motion picture business and did movies. But a lot of times it didn't work in movies because they didn't understand why they were doing what they were doing, the choices they were making. So being fresh and young and not knowing all of the things that can hinder your creativity is a wonderful place to be. So, I mean, when I approach a project, I try to forget the fact that I'm a producer when I'm focusing on the directing aspect of it. Mm-hmm. Right, and it again, the focus of your class is staying in the business once you get in the business, correct? Okay. Well, an aspect that I can talk about is, for instance, this last movie I did, Impact Earth. None of the producers had ever produced anything. So I basically was tutoring a lot of the producers as to how to make a movie and to decisions that we should make. And that worked and was beneficial to the project However, I bored Rex and he's walking away now, huh? I didn't hear anything you said, but whatever, I'll continue. You guys can still hear me? Okay, okay. So, oh, no, so the point I was making is, in imparting my knowledge, in quotations, to these novice producers, I managed to piss off the executive producer who financed the thing, because he was a guy who thought he knew everything, brought in people that had lied to him saying they knew how to do stuff, and, you know, now because of that, this guy won't talk to me. So you have to be careful. It's a fine line, and you really don't know it until you cross it. You know, I've always said I don't burn bridges, I blow them up. And some of the people, it's good, because I wouldn't want to work with them again. But there's a huge political element in the movie business. And knowing how to navigate that can be difficult at times. But at the end of the day, you know, you have to be true to yourself and true to your own beliefs and feelings, whatever they are. So, you know, I've done projects with other novice producers that were very grateful for the knowledge that I imparted, or whatever you want to call it, the information I gave them. But, for instance, this last picture, this one exec producer, I mean, he won't talk to me, he won't talk to the other producers. So it's, I bring that up just because, even though, you know, the picture did really well in the foreign markets, but this exec producer did everything he could. He didn't help the film. He forced us to take composers on that had never composed movie music. So, I mean, he screwed up a lot of shit, if you ask me. But, you know, that's why I'd like to talk to him, just because he has a lot of money. But it's not worth it sometimes, because he screwed up this project when he didn't have to. So, you know, you have to be, once you get in the biz, you have to be careful of how you, of the people you align yourselves with. And, you know, you always work hard, you're nice, you're polite, and you learn. One of the first movies I ever did was this horror movie called Mother's Day. This is back in the late 70s. And I was still in college at the time. And the producer of it said to me, one of the greatest things that I've always carried on and, you know, say, there's nothing wrong with asking questions. Don't assume you know how to do anything. You know, ask the question if you have any, if you have any concerns. A funny aside, I was doing this other movie right after it called Ms. 45. We were shooting in Manhattan. And I would go to school, and then I'd cut my liberal arts classes so I could work on films. And we're shooting down in Chinatown. And the AD comes up and says, Piano, go clean up all this crap over on a sidewalk. And we're in Chinatown in New York. It was disgusting. So I didn't want to touch it with my hands. So I grabbed something, and I started cleaning the crap out of the gutter. And I mean, it was disgusting, you know, dead cats, old food, blah, blah, blah. So I look at this piece of metal that I've grabbed, and it's covered in this crap now. So I throw it away. Well, unbeknownst to me, because I didn't know what I was grabbing the control arm to the dolly. So just as we go back to shoot, the key grip is like, where the hell's the control arm to control the dolly? And I'm like, oh, shit, I just threw it out. So now I grabbed it because I didn't want to get dirty. Now I'm rummaging through the garbage, trying to find this stupid piece of equipment, which I never did find. And, of course, I never said that I'd taken it. But it was, you know, a lesson learned when I was, what, 18 years old. So the point of this is, when you're on a movie set and you're working, don't assume you know anything, or, you know, assume you know certain stuff. But don't, if you have any questions, always ask them. It's much better to ask a question to do something and do it wrong. Damien? Good, good, good. But you know that line, of course, from The Omen. Oh, my God, it's one of the greatest movies. You have to see the original with Gregory Peck. Sorry, yes. Well, no, this guy was actually, he was the executive producer of the project. So, generally, the producer manages. A producer's role is to essentially overall manage the financial aspects of the movie as well as the creative. Well, a good producer will back up his director and try to enable the director to achieve what he wants by allocating funds to certain parts of the budget. You know, it's a macro position versus a micro. In the micro, the production manager or the line producer manage the day-to-day cash allotments. Pardon me. A producer is there to manage the overall production as well as help the director and add his creative stamp to the project. An exec producer is generally someone that brings the financing to the project. I hope that answered your question, Damien. Yeah, those you want to stay away from. I like the movies that have all their money before they shoot. Yes, sir, in the back. Well, it's interesting. When I've done a bunch of movies for Lifetime, and I'll get to that in 1 second. The weirdest thing I ever got, I was directing a movie for the Animal Planet called Hope Ranch, which was like a modern day cowboy movie where juvenile delinquents go to a dude ranch. So before we start to shoot, I get this booklet from Animal Planet of all the things that I cannot and should not do in the movie. And it's broken down in terms of props, in terms of gestures. For instance, in America, this is the peace sign. In Europe or England or somewhere, it means go fuck yourself, pardon my French. So they were like, don't have any of your actors throw the peace sign. It was a cowboy movie, so we have a big barbecue. There's a whole thing. We want to sell the movie to Asia and the Middle East. So you can't eat beef because cows are sacred. So I'm like, what the hell? We're doing a cowboy movie. They're going to have veggie burgers? I'm like, give me a break. So, you know, certain things you can almost, you can't please everybody. Luckily, the exec on that show was a very savvy, smart guy. Regarding Lifetime, the last movie I did that was supposed to go to Lifetime was this picture called Dangerous Isolation. And the cool thing about Dangerous Isolation, you guys, have you seen that show Orphan Black? I haven't seen it. But you know this little girl in it, Tatiana Maslany, I think is her name, who was just nominated for an Emmy. This was her first movie. So she was terrific. She was probably 16 years old when I did it. But anyway, the script had all the bad guys in the movie smoking cigarettes all the time. Lifetime had read the script. The producers had read the script for the company that I was making it for. So I'm shooting the movie. The bad guys are always smoking cigarettes. We finish it. The movie is really good. Lifetime turns it down because there are people smoking cigarettes in it. And then the producers come to me and say, why'd you let people smoke the cigarettes? And I said, guys, I didn't write the script. You're the ones that gave it to me. Lifetime saw it. It said everywhere the bad guys are smoking cigarettes. Why didn't you tell me they can't smoke cigarettes? So that killed the Lifetime sale. So in terms of creativity, you know, I haven't had the deal directly with Lifetime. The producers had, and they'd hired me. So basically they hired me to produce or to direct a picture based on a previous film that did really well. Then my first Lifetime movie did really well, which led to me doing four other ones. And like I said, the last one should have been on Lifetime, but because people were smoking cigarettes, it wasn't. Hello, Zach. Yeah. Oh no, look, on every movie you at least tear your hair out once. I've shot a lot of movies on this island in the Caribbean called Grand Turk, which I love. It's like you may as well be in Siberia shooting. So I've shot about six pictures there. On each one, I'm pulling my hair out for different reasons. But it's wonderful reasons because I'm working. So, one, we all show up at the location. And, you know, there's the whole crew, 40 people waiting around. Everyone's ready to shoot. And the line producer shows up and says, oh, we can't get in this location. I'm like, what do you mean we can't get in the location? He goes, well, they said we could shoot. Now that we're there, they're not letting us. So I looked around and I saw a building that had an open door. And I said, okay, we'll shoot in that building over there. He's like, well, you haven't been in it. I said, I don't care. I said, we got to shoot something. So we walked over there and we shot it. Every time you come up to these kind of challenges, again, I was on Grand Turk and we're shooting and the lights start to flicker and there's this massive explosion. And the generator exploded. So now we have to continue shooting without any power. So the scene that was supposed to be inside, we took it outside. I mean, I've shot scenes when we've lost power with the headlights of cars. So you have to be prepared to just do whatever it takes to get something done. On this movie Impact Earth, you know, I pulled my hair out because one of our second ADs wasn't paying attention and I finally get the shot and then I watch the daily back and there's a looky-loo. a neighbor standing on their porch watching us. So, you know, there are little aggravating things like that that drive you nuts every day. Me getting married? That was a picture I did called The Month of August, I think what you're talking about, which is a sweet little romantic comedy. And the continuity person. When you work, your continuity person is kind of like the librarian who keeps track of everything you're shooting. I rely probably too heavily on my script supervisors because I'll block shoot a lot of times, which if you don't know what block shooting means, sometimes you don't have the time in the day to shoot in sequential order. Say in a room, if I wanted to get a close-up of me and then of you guys, well, sometimes I'd have to relight to turn around the camera. And I've done several TV shows where we've never had the time or the money to light both sides, just one side at a time. So it's called block shooting, which means you shoot out everything in one direction. Then you turn around and you start from the very beginning and shoot out everything that you're missing in the opposite direction. So in doing this one movie, it was the key moment at the end of this movie where the guy finally tells the girl he loves her. And of course, I didn't shoot it in a close-up. So I was like, I said, did we get this in a close-up? Oh yeah, we got it, we got it. We got everything else except for him saying in a close-up, I love you, which, you know, was my fault, was the continuity person's fault. I mean, so there are things that I now do, or I try to do, if I don't get, like, caught up and wrapped up in the frenzy of shooting. And I said this to you on one of the shows, you know, when I was producing a TV series, I'd work with multiple directors. They would come in, they'd do an episode, they'd leave. This one director, his name was Bill Tannen, very, very talented man. And I was watching him, and he had his script with the different characters with different colored highlighters on it. And I said, what is that for? And he said, oh, it's a way to remind me of moments I want to capture. Also, you know, I'll then cross it out once I've gotten it. So now what I do, I stole that from him, is when I'm doing a picture, I'll keep different colored highlighters and I'll write in the script before, make sure you get a close-up and then of this line. And then once I get it, I mark it off just to kind of cover my own ass. Because even though your DP will help you, your script person will help you, sometimes, you know, they forget or they're busy doing something else. So I kind of try to make sure I don't screw things up by keeping a visual log of what I've done.
Because what you said there about
Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah, well, what was interesting, I mean, a lot of the creative choices you make, or I make, are intuitive. What you feel you need visually. What was real interesting, I produced and I directed an animated movie. And I actually hate animation, you know, these stupid kind of movies. But what was interesting about it, first was directing just the voice talent, because I approached it like it was a radio show. So I would close my eyes and listen to the actors performing and direct them so that it was better auditorily, if that's a word, than visually, because there was no visuals. There were no visuals at the time. And then what I did was I went through the script with a highlighter again and found what I believed were the emotional beats in each scene. Moments that would progress the story in a dramatic way. So by the time I was done, you know, every page had a few marks on it, highlight marks. And then in my pre-visualization of the movie, I knew, okay, this has to be emphasized. So whatever my camera's doing, I need a close-up of this. Or I've also used extreme wide shots to emphasize stuff. I mean, I've done scenes where you cut back really wide. I mean, this is what I've thought. I don't know if it works, but you cut back really wide so you barely hear what the actors are saying, so you physically have to lean into the TV hoping that it's more dynamic than, you know, a big close-up of someone saying it right in your face. When I do that, I also cover the close-up in case the wide shot doesn't work. But, so, you know, in the pre-viz part of doing animation, and it translates to film as well, or, you know, live-action movie making, because you have to pre-viz the film in your head as a director, because you're not always going to have the time to get the coverage you want. You have to understand editing. And if you have these areas highlighted in your story, you'll make sure that you get that moment in a close-up, if that's how you decide to do it.
Good. Very good.
Oh, God, yes. And well, not only is it an odd thing to make, it's an odd movie. I mean, it's like that project, an old partner of mine had acquired the film rights to it. And I don't know how we got the script. I might have written, I mean, I'm sure I wrote part of it, but we got this guy, Martin Olson, who is a very talented writer. He works at Disney now, or he probably worked there then as well. And he was primarily a sketch writer. So the script was, what doesn't work in the movie is the fact that it's a bunch of skits put together. Also, the picture didn't know if it should have been an adult movie or skewed to a kid's movie. So, I mean, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie. It's really bizarre. And there's some, like, weird singing in it. It's not that I didn't enjoy working on the animated movies. I just don't. That's not my bailiwick. I'm not a big fan of, you know, any of these animated movies, Pixar, any of that stuff. It's just not my thing. I prefer 2D animation, like the old Tex Avery stuff. But the picture Elf Bowling was something that I was brought into late after they had hired an animation company that, after spending like $3 million, didn't have anything to deliver. So they brought, the producer brought me in to help him facilitate this thing with this other producer, director, who had done a lot of films in Korea. And that's where all the animation was done. This other producer, director, also directed that movie, The Littlest Angel, the other animated film I did. Because his expertise is animation. He's Korean. He speaks Korean. He went to Korea to oversee all the physical animation, the production of it. I don't know any of that stuff. I mean, I learned just enough to get through the project, but from a technical side, I don't know any of that. What I did primarily on that was make sure that we had the proper coverage using my live action experience. And also I directed all of the talent. I created the radio play before we got to it. But we also had the good fortune of having voice actors. We had Tom Kenny in it, who is SpongeBob. So this guy was brilliant, ad-libbing stuff. We also had, I forget the guy's name, Joe, I want to say Alesco, but that's probably incorrect, who took over for Mel Blanc at Warner Brothers. So he's now the voice of the Looney Tunes. So, I mean, we had these wonderful actors who their whole career has been doing cartoons that would ad-lib stuff that was just terrific. So, I mean, the movie isn't really a very good movie, but there's some wonderful, weird little moments in it. And it really has almost nothing to do with the game that everybody used to play, other than the name of it. Hello, Jake. Both things have happened. I mean, the last project that I did that I was supposed to do, because this movie Impact Earth did well, Stars said, look, we're going to give you guys a two-picture deal. Here are the parameters. One has to be an earthquake movie. The other one has to be an action disaster movie. So one of the producers and I came up with, you know, we wrote basically 10 treatments for different projects or for different styles of movies. Submitted those to Stars. Stars said yes on this one, yes on that one, no on the others. So we then set out and I wrote the script based on, you know, they wanted the script that I wrote. They came back and said, we want Die Hard meets The Towering Inferno. So I was like, and we want to do it for $2. I was like, oh, wonderful. So, that we wrote. And that's the one that we were supposed to do this year, except the exec producers didn't raise the funds for it. So you know, as a, I've written a bunch of stuff on my own. It's usually too bizarre or weird that I've never gotten any real good responses. I mean, I've optioned about 10 scripts. I have one movie that I made, which is probably the one movie made that I wrote. That's probably like one of the worst scripts ever shot because we wrote it in a week. But you know, as a, because I have a background in writing, I mean, I always write, I always have a story that I want to tell. It's just that the stories I want to tell doesn't seem a lot of people want to see them. So the last script I wrote was a murder mystery comedy about giant vegetable farmers in Alaska. So, you know, there's not a big market for that stuff. Right. Right. Well, for instance, you know, like I said, I said to the executive, I said, guys, you know, you want $100 million movie for less than $1 million. So it ain't going to be Towering Inferno. It's going to be Four Story Inferno. And it ain't going to be Die Hard. It's going to be Die Kinda Soft. You know, I said, we can't do those things. So, I mean, as a writer, I have to, when I approach something like this, and this was basically a work for hire that I knew I would be directing. So I put on my writer hat, my director hat, and then I fall back on my producer hat and say, okay, I have to have a limited cast. I have to structure the story so that I can shoot out all of my extras within about a 2-day period. So I basically watched Die Hard. I mean, I love the movie. It's one of the greatest action movies ever made. But I analyzed it and created a spreadsheet with every scene in the movie as I watched it. And then I went back and I looked at it and I was like, okay, these five scenes are basically all the same shot that have been intercut with other moments. So I found shortcuts as to how to do my ripoff of Die Hard by watching how it was done initially. Then I created, okay, I need all these extras to make the project look big in scope and then scale. So I wrote, you know, all of our hostages were in one room that I could shoot out all of the sequences in about 2 days. Then all of the other sequences I structured so that there were limited amount of people in them. So once I took this jigsaw puzzle and put it all back together, it read like a big movie when in fact it was a lot of smaller scenes that had two or three people in them. So that juxtaposed against the bigger scenes, it would give the impression of a bigger movie. So that's how I attack that one. And that's how you kind of have to attack when you're doing any of these low-budget movies. You try to find a way to make it look bigger and sexier than it is. Oh, sure. I mean, right. Well, I mean, there's now the industry has become so fragmented. There's, I mean, there was always like commercial directors. All they did were commercials. Then, I guess it was in the 80s, a lot of the commercial directors, I mean, Michael Bay started in commercials. Bob Giraldi, the top guys in commercials then started directing features. And big studio features. A lot of the rock video guys moved into features and TV shows. Now with reality, that's a whole other group of directors that primarily do just reality shows. And it's not to say that you can't jump between them, but you have to understand how each one is done. And you kind of align yourself with what aspect of the industry interests you the most. I started as a production assistant working in New York on low-budget horror movies and on TV commercials, because that's what the industry was in New York when I started. I always aspired to be a director of films. And it took me, you know, like I was in the industry for about 17 years before I got my shot at directing anything. And in the ensuing times, you know, I was a prop man. I did every job on a movie set from grip to electric. Hell, I've even done makeup and, you know, all of these different things just to try to learn what was going on. And to understand the craft of filmmaking, be it TV shows, movies, whatever. Then when, in the late 80s, I moved out to California because the industry was kind of dying in New York. And I started working for a company doing travel videos. I'd never done a travel video. But, you know, part of this was we'd travel around the world and shoot videos on cool places to go. And the company I worked for also owned this really bad version of a 1960s pop group. So they would come around and we would do really stupid variety shows wherever we were staying with this pop group singing. So, I mean, I learned all these weird things that I'd never thought I'd ever be doing. And, you know, just kept building up a wealth of a body of work behind me. But in terms of directing, there are different avenues out there and mediums to direct in. So, you know, you kind of getting your shot is the hardest thing. Short films, doing the festival route is a great way. I mean, an anecdotal story. This was years ago. I was directing a lot of television shows. Silk Stockings, Mike Hammer, Air America, shows that weren't network shows. They were syndicated shows, one-hour dramatic TV shows. And there was a meeting at the Directors Guild that I was at, and you know, I basically said, guys, what do I have to do to break into the network to direct a network TV show? And one of the guys said, maybe you should do a short film. I was like, I've done 60 of them. They're called television shows that you can watch on, you know, not on the network, but on whatever. So, I mean, the short film route is a very good way to show what you've got to say and show your talent and your ability. And, you know, in doing those short films, I think it's key that you do something that's meaningful to you. Don't try, or maybe you should try to appease the others. I remember when I was in film school, everyone, you know, we had a film class called Junior Narrative, which was the first time you got to make a movie with sound, with lip sync. And everybody made, you know, not everybody, I mean, I guess about 10 people in the classes made the kind of movies they wanted to make. And a lot of them were really heartfelt stories about losing a grandparent or something, you know, something that really tugged at your heartstrings. Well, I made a 1950s musical spoof of sci-fi movies about a kid who's experimented on by his father and turns into a gorilla, and he ends up taking a girl to the prom who ends up turning into a pig. So at the end of the school year, my teacher loved the film, but the dean almost refused to show it at the NYU Film Festival because it just didn't, you know, it wasn't like a heartfelt, tug at your heartstrings kind of movie. Mine was a wacky, goofy, stupid musical. So, but it was what I wanted to make. It was the kind of stories that I liked. So, you know, don't take my advice and do something that, it got me a lot of notice, though, I will say that. But, you know, you got to follow your heart and what you love to tell, that kind of a story. If that made any sense, my ramblings. Good question, Stephanie. Before I ever directed TV, I had, and this was just out of naivete and not knowing anything, I had little regard for television directors. I thought the only place to direct was, you know, a movie. Once I produced a TV series, and I had never produced a TV series until I got this one job, I never realized how good a director you have to be to direct television. When I was an AD making movies, we would do maybe 3 to 4 pages a day. When I was hired to produce this TV series, I look at the call sheet and it's 11 pages a day. And I said to my boss, I'm like, I don't even know, how the hell do you do this? How do you do 11 pages a day? And he said, after 3 days, you'll know how you do it. And when I watched these seasoned TV directors and the DP cover creatively 11 pages in one day, I had the utmost respect for television directors. Because what you are expected to do is to deliver something as good as a feature in a quarter or a third of the time. And when I would do films, I never knew how to economize my shooting using a camera and a dolly or a zoom lens. Everything was an individual shot on its own. Well, when you do television, you know, you'd put the camera on a dolly, you'd follow the two people coming in the room, and once they land where they're going to talk, you either dolly into a close-up so that now you just owe one shot, a reverse, and now that scene is covered. Whereas in a film, you would do it in 3 setups. You're now doing it in 2 setups. So, I mean, I learned all of this stuff, how to be more creative by virtue of being forced to tell the story in less than half the time as I would on a feature film. You know, you pick the moments and the things that you need to tell to make it as dynamic as a feature film. So I would put up a good film TV director against any film director. Well, you know, look, the walk and talks there, what you have to do, another thing I learned from producing, this was, again, before I became a director, I would get, you know, every day I'd get a call sheet as well as a production report as to what we had covered, what had been shot already. Then I would get I had a pager, and when you're producing television shows, it's checkerboarded. So while they're shooting one episode, I'm prepping the next episode with the next director. So I would get a 911 page, which meant there's an emergency on the set. Come down here and solve the problem. So I'd go down and I'd say, the AD would tell me, look, we have 30 minutes left. The director wants to cover this scene in four shots. We have time for one shot. So I would look at the production report. And I would see if there was coverage in the scene prior to that had already been shot, or the outgoing scene that had already been shot. And if there was, then I'd say, okay, we're doing this in one shot, i.e. the walk and talk. Or, so that would dictate how I got out of these problems. If that made any sense to you guys. I don't know if it did. Do you guys know what production reports are and all of that stuff? Production report basically is a document that tells you all of the scenes that you have shot, the amount of coverage in each shot, what is remaining to be shot. So it's essentially the film on a piece of, on a document that you can see coverage-wise, you know, what you still owe, etc. So that's a great tool that allowed me to immediately see where our status was within the production of the series, of the show. Sure. Oh, sure. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I mean, listen, the unions, you know, I'm a member of the Directors Guild, and but however, I'm a financial core member, which means that I can work union and non-union, because what happened was when I started directing, the shows were all non-union. Even though most of our crew were union people. Then all of the movies I directed for Lifetime, for Animal Planet, they were all non-union because the cable networks didn't want to sign agreements with the unions. So the Directors Guild of America said to me, you can't do these jobs. And I said, guys, I'm directing these movies. So I got fined all kinds of money for directing these movies. And after about 2 years, I said, you know what? I'm going to go financial corps, which the unions frown on, but it's your constitutional right to do so. I would much rather do union pictures because I then get residuals and I'm protected. And now what has happened with the industry is everyone has made concessions so that more projects can be union. And I think it's better because the unions have made concessions wherein they're still protecting their members, but they have different tiers. So depending on your budget, you have different tiers of payment. Yet everyone still abides and has to abide by the rules in theory. You know, when I started making these low-budget horror movies, we would work 18, 20 hours a day. And, I mean, it was very dangerous. I fell asleep so damn many times driving my car. Thank God I didn't get in an accident. Unfortunately, you know, a lot of people have been killed that way. And when you do a picture, you know, safety is the most important thing, in my opinion. And I've done a lot of action things where we blow up stuff, car crashes, et cetera, et cetera. But nothing is worth hurting someone. And it's very important that, you know, you try to maintain work everything a 12-hour day at the longest. And, you know, the unions are a huge proponent of that, and I totally agree with it. I mean, it makes fiscal sense, and it makes just humanitarian sense. Sure. Well, listen, one of the key things about directing and producing is being organized. And you can't emphasize that enough. As a director, you know, I go into everything. I have shot lists for everything I plan to do. And sometimes I throw them out. But at least it gives me a basis from which to work, and it tells me, you know, I've got a game plan. I might have to change it all because something will inspire me more. But at least I know what I need to cover. And, you know, it's being prepared. I mean, that's part of the job, regardless of what you do. You know, when I was a prop man, I had to do that. I'd see the call sheet. I'd see the props. I'd have to make sure my prop kit was loaded properly. You know, that I had everything I needed, as well as alternatives in case the director didn't like that. Pardon me. So, organization and the pre-production planning is key in every job in the movie industry, because it's basically location work. You're a traveling circus. If you don't have it with you, you're not going to have it, and somebody's going to get pissed off that it's not there. Sure. I mean, listen, a company move, if you guys don't know, a company move is when you load up all the trucks, you move to another location, you download all the trucks. In the best case scenario, you're going to lose at least 2 hours. 2 hours is a lot of time when you're doing a movie within the day. A cart move is when you're basically moving within the location to another location. I remember I was directing this episode of a TV show. They used to call them, at the end of the season, when you'd run out of money and you still had shows to do, the executive producers would say, hey, let's do a show in only one location. They'd call them a bottle show. I don't know why the term bottle came up, but that's what they would call it. So I have to direct this show that in theory is in one location. It's in one building. Within the building, there are 60 different locations. So I'm looking at these guys. I'm like, look, we got 3 days to do this. I need more than 3 days. Why? It's only one location, Rex. And I'm like, no, it's 60 locations all under one roof. They're on different floors of the building, et cetera, et cetera. We managed to do it, but, you know, it didn't take us 2 hours to move. It took us 30 minutes to move. And we could leave base company where it was. We could leave all of our equipment in the main room and just go off on almost little units, mini units, to shoot what we had to shoot. So, pardon me. You try to keep company moves down to a minimum because, A, they're expensive. You have to start up all the trucks. You have to move the whole circus. And B, they're time consuming. So if you don't have to do them, you don't want to do them.
When do you want to start?
You know, I've always, because you can control interior lighting, every time I schedule a movie, you want to schedule it that you start day exterior. Then, like on that last Impact Earth movie, you know, we'd shot at one house. Like within this house, I think we had like 12 pages. So we started exterior day. While we were shooting outside, they were lighting the interior. We then moved inside to shoot the day interiors. While we were inside shooting that, they were preparing lights for outside for the night exterior, you know, roughing in everything so that people were constantly working to try to get us out within the time allotted. So it varies on each production. I shot this movie in the Caribbean, and this is the weirdest thing I'd ever done. We had 1 day left to shoot, and it was a night exterior, the climax of the movie. We're out at this rock quarry where there's a chase, a guy falls, you know, the hero saves the day. So that morning, we find out that a scene we'd shot previously got screwed up somewhere. I don't know where, but I had to reshoot it. It was a day exterior scene. So what we ended up doing, and this is the only time I've ever done it, we shot our night scene first, then went into day exteriors. So it was, you know, a 180 on what you normally do. So we'd shot all night, and then our lunch was like at 6 in the morning, and wherein we'd normally be going back to bed, we then shot this day exterior scene because we had to. So. Matt, I love just working. when I was doing TV, I had the luxury of being on about four TV series, and I was booked to work like 2 years in advance. And it was the most secure I've ever felt in this business. It was wonderful because every week it was like making a new movie. And it was like probably the most creative time I'd ever had. Because with television, you would direct the show, you'd spend about a day with the editor, and then I would start prepping the next show. When I do films, it's a much longer process. You know, it's usually a minimum of 3 weeks to a maximum of 6 weeks for these TV movies of prep. And then you shoot it, and then you're in editing for about a month. So it's like, it's a much longer time of your life for a lot less money. So, and the problem is, because of the nature of these TV movies, you have to, I mean, when I was directing episodes of television, everyone, it would be as good as it could be within a week. Boom, move on to the next one. With these movies of the week for TV, everyone treats them like you're making Gone with the Wind or like you're making this Oscar-nominated movie. Meanwhile, you know, you're making this stupid movie about a friggin' meteor that's going to hit the planet that nobody gives a crap about that you shouldn't spend that much time on. Yet these people want to, and as the director, you kind of have to. So I'd rather be making episodic TV again, but it's, you know, the kind of episodic TV I made, they stopped making a long time ago, and to break into the networks is very, very difficult. Well, it, you know, again, I can't necessarily say that I did it the best way. I just wanted to work, and because I knew nothing about the industry, I started out as a production assistant, which, you know, is probably where most folks start out. And because I lived in New York, I started out there. I probably should have gone out to California earlier in my career than I did. If you want to start in the industry as a director, I would suggest you go where it doesn't cost you anything to live and you can make a film as your calling card. Now, if you've done that in college, before you move anywhere, I would suggest you send that out to the various different agencies to try to get representation. There's smart ways about going about this, none of which I did. I moved out to California not knowing a soul, but at the time, my writing partner and I, we moved out there. And, you know, after about 6 months, we got a job. And, again, this was for this wacky company making these travel videos. And, you know, one thing led to another, and I started to network and meet more people. If you want to just work, if you want to, if you aspire just to work in the industry and want to figure out what you want to do, because not everybody will be a director, not everybody will be a producer. They're cameramen, they're grips, they're all of these wonderful jobs. Then you try to go where you can get the work and the experience. I'm sure in Milwaukee there's a good commercial corporate video area there. Actually, a buddy of mine is in Milwaukee and he has a corporate video company. Do you know Ron Halpern? I think he's in, isn't he in Milwaukee? I think so. I mean, the thing is to gain experience doing what you want to do, or finding a path that will lead you to what you wanted to do, what you want to do. I thought being an assistant director would lead me that way, and I was completely wrong. I was an AD for about 15 years, and it led me down the path of becoming a producer. Once Right. I didn't know that. And it just got me, being a first AD, got me out of humping grip equipment and electric cables, which I didn't want to do, and stopped me from being a prop man. but what it did do was it led to me to become a production manager, which led to become a line producer, which led to become a producer, which in turn, once I was producing a TV series, allowed me to become a director. So it was like a wacky, crazy way to get there, but that's how I became a director. And it helped me in terms of, I by the time I was directing, I understood everything about making a movie. I still didn't understand everything about being a director. And I made mistakes as a first-time director on TV shows. But, you know, that's how I got into the biz. So, I mean, what you guys should do is decide. I mean, by this time in your college education, you should have an idea, I would think, as to what you do want to do. And you kind of have to map out a strategy to get there. And, you know, when I was in college, I went to college with Chris Columbus. He was a year ahead of me. But Chris, brilliant guy, brilliant writer, brilliant producer, director. While we were in college, he sold a script for $1 million. So his path was, based on his talent, was pretty cut and dry. You know, I went to school with a lot of guys that aren't in the business anymore. So, I mean, everyone's going to have their unique way of finding out what they do on their unique path, but it's something you have to figure out on your own. You know, I don't know if when I went to California at the time, NYU, which is where I went to school, had a pretty strong alumni group out there. And, you know, we'd have get-togethers, and it was all about networking and finding a way that somebody could possibly help you. And you need those feet in the door and those leg ups to get into this business. And then to stay in the business, you have to work hard, learn, and basically not be an a-hole. And, you know, yeah. I said, good luck. Yeah. And I know you want to hear my voice for another hour or so. Alrighty, guys. Take care, everybody. Thanks again.
Alrighty, man. Bye-bye.